Hello all, so let's discuss about now an autocorticoid known as serotonin. And with serotonin we will also discuss the treatment of migraine. So migraine is a type of headache, okay? So let's talk about first serotonin, okay? So serotonin is a type of a local hormone. That means it is synthesized by the cell and it act locally in the adjacent cell. They are also known as autocorticoids. Autocorticoid means self-acting. Now, from where this word has come, what is the origin of this word or etymology? Sero means it was first identified in human serum or plasma. And tonin means it increases the tone of the blood vessel because it produces vasoconstriction. Okay? It produces vasoconstriction. So from there the word serotonin came. So it produces vasoconstriction. So it says it is present in our serum and it produces vasoconstriction. Okay. Now, let's see how serotonin is synthesized. Synthesis. So serotonin, remember the name. Another name of serotonin is also known as 5-hydroxytryptamine. Okay. 5-hydroxytryptamine. It is another name of serotonin. Okay, so serotonin is also known as 5-hydroxytryptamine. As you are seeing, it is an amine. It is synthesized from an amino acid. So how it is synthesized? It is synthesized from an amino acid known as tryptophan. Okay, now first of all, this tryptophan gets converted into 5-hydroxytryptophan. 5-hydroxytryptophan by an enzyme known as tryptophan hydroxylase. Tryptophan hydroxylase. So this enzyme will add hydroxyl group. Now after this, there is an enzyme which will convert this 5-hydroxytryptophan into 5-hydroxytryptamine. Okay. Now remember, from any amino acid has two terminal. One carboxylic terminal, second is amine terminal. Amine carboxylic. Now if you will remove this carboxylic terminal, the part of amino acid which will remain is amine. So if you will remove this carboxylic group, it will become an amine. So tryptophan will become tryptamine. Hence the enzyme which is required is tryptophan decarboxylase enzyme. Okay. So if you will remove this carboxylic group from this amino acid, tryptamine will become, and this 5-hydroxytryptamine is serotonin. It is another name of serotonin. Okay. Now how this serotonin is degraded? Serotonin is degraded by an enzyme known as MAO enzyme. So let's see how it is degraded. It is degraded by an enzyme known as MAO enzyme. MAO stands for mono amine oxidase. So it's an amine. So the enzyme which will degrade it, monoamine oxidase, and it will convert it into 5-hydroxy indole acetic acid. Okay, so the enzyme which is responsible for degradation of serotonin is MAO enzyme. Okay, now the point is, before going further, remember we have developed a new drug which will inhibit tryptophan hydroxylase enzyme. So the drug which inhibits this enzyme is trisat ethyl. So the drug which inhibits tryptophan hydroxylase enzyme is trisat ethyl. And where this drug is used? This drug is used for the treatment of diarrhea, which is seen in cases of carcinoid syndrome. So carcinoid is a tumor of GIT cells generally, which secretes very large amount of serotonin. So if you will inhibit this enzyme, serotonin will not be synthesized. So carcinoid tumor or carcinoid syndrome, there is diarrhea due to high level of serotonin. Normally the drug of choice for carcinoid syndrome is somatostatin hormone octreotide. So this telotrestat is given in octreotide resistant cases of carcinoid syndrome. So normally the drug of choice is of carcinoid syndrome is octreotide. In octreotide resistant cases, we give telotrestat ethyl. Okay, so octreotide will inhibit the secretion of serotonin from the cells. Now let's see what is the source of serotonin. Serotonin is present in which cells? Okay, so serotonin, remember, it is mainly present, 90% of the body serotonin, it is present in a cell known as enterochromaffin cell. 90% of the serotonin is present in enterochromaffin cells of GIT. Okay, and rest of the serotonin is present in platelets, where it is responsible for platelet aggregation, and it is present in our brain, and it functions as a neurotransmitter in our brain. Rest is mainly present in brain, it acts as a neurotransmitter. So this is the normal physiology of serotonin. Now let's see how serotonin produces its effect. Now serotonin produces effect by acting on serotonin receptors. It produces effect by acting on serotonin receptors. And remember, the receptors of serotonin, they are also known as 5-HT receptors. So receptors of serotonin are known as 5-HT receptor. Why? 5-HT is the short form of 5-hydroxytryptamine. Okay, so we have written 5-hydroxytryptamine. The short form of 5-hydroxytryptamine is 5-HT. So it is another name of serotonin. Now remember, there are seven types of receptors of serotonin. They range from 5-HT1 to 5-HT7. Okay, there are seven types. Now remember, they all are GPCR. Okay, they all are GPCR. That means G protein coupled receptors, which has a snake-like structure, except 5-HT3. 5-HT3 is an ionotropic receptor. 5-HT3 is an ionotropic receptors. Okay? So remember this part. Now, for the clinical part, if you talk about the drugs, for clinically important, remember, we have to discuss only four types. We have to discuss only four types, because again, these four types of receptors, we have certain drugs. So what is important for us is from 5-HT1 to 5-HT4 receptors. That is clinically important. Okay, and let's see what are the receptors and what are the drugs we have. Okay, let's see what are the receptors. So let's talk about the first receptor of serotonin and what are the drugs which we have which act on them. Okay, so let's talk about first, that is 5-HT1 receptor. 5-HT1 receptor. Okay, now 5-HT1 receptor is which type of receptor? You will write, it is a GPCR, and among GPCR it is GI type. I means inhibitory receptor. Okay, and if we talk about the location, in location, it is present in our brain, CNS, that is central nervous system, and it is present in blood vessels. Okay, now in brain, remember, it is presynaptic autoreceptor. It is presynaptic autoreceptor. It means there are certain neurons which releases serotonin as a neurotransmitter. And ideally, this serotonin should act on other organs of the body. So this area is generally known as synapse. So generally, if the receptors are present on other cells, these are known as postsynaptic receptor. But remember, 5-HT1 receptor, they are present on the same neuron which are releasing serotonin. So they are 5-HT1 receptors. So that is why they are known as presynaptic. Now the point is, as they are inhibitory receptor GI type, remember when serotonin acts on its own receptor, it applies a brake. And because of this reason, it reduces the release of serotonin. It further reduces the release of serotonin. So that is why these receptors are autoreceptor. Auto means they are modulating their own release. And in blood vessel, remember, we know serotonin, as the word implies, it causes vasoconstriction. Now let's see what are the drugs we have. Now, these 5-HT1 receptor is further divided into various subtypes. And let's see what are the drugs we have. Okay. So the first class of drug we have is 5-HT1A agonist. Agonist means it will stimulate the receptor. And these drugs are known as azapirones. And among them we have various drugs like buspirone, G-pyrone, ipsapyrone. And among them, right now, buspirone has been approved and it is given as an anti-anxiety drug. Okay, so A for anxiety. The next class of drug we have is 5-HT1B1D agonist. This is the most important class. So it's the most important one. And these drugs are known as, that is, triptans. The drugs are triptans. And they are selective drug. That means they don't act on any other receptor. They only act on this receptor. And also we have a drug, ergots. But remember, ergots are non-selective drug. They act on other receptor as well. Okay? They act on other receptors as well. Now, where these drugs are used? Remember, these drugs are used in the treatment of acute attack of migraine. Okay? They are used in acute attack of migraine. And remember, for acute attack of migraine, triptans are the drug of choice because they are even more effective than ergots. Okay, so we will discuss these drugs shortly in great detail. Okay, great detail. Now the third drug we have is 5-HT1F agonist. Okay, now these drugs are known as ditans. Among them, we have one drug that is lesmiditan. Now, this drug is under trials, right now not approved. And it is under trial for acute attack of migraine. But right now, this drug is not approved. Okay. So, this drug right now is not approved. So, among them, to discuss about buspirone, please refer to the chapter of CNS, anti-anxiety drug or antidepressant drug. But the thing you just have to remember is this one. Now let's discuss about these two drugs in great detail. That is triptans and ergots. Okay. So let's make a heading, that is triptans. Then we will come to 5-HT2 receptor. tryptons. So we know that tryptons are selective. 5-HT1B1D agonist. Okay. Now, these tryptons, they are the drug of choice for acute attack of migraine. Okay. They are the best drug we have for acute attack of migraine. Okay. But remember, they are not used for prevention of migraine or prophylaxis of migraine. They are only given during acute attack. Okay. Now, let's see what is their mechanism of action in migraine and why migraine occurs. Okay. Now, what is migraine? Migraine is a type of episodic headache. Which is sometimes associated with aura. Aura means associated symptoms. Now, this headache is generally unilateral, that means one-sided, throbbing, and it is severe in intensity, very severe headache. And it is associated with certain other symptoms as well, like there is nausea, vomiting, there is photophobia, and there is phonophobia, that means sensitivity to light and sensitivity to voices. Okay. Now, what is the cause of this headache? The exact cause of migraine we don't know, but remember, it is believed, suppose this is the brain. In brain, in this area, generally we have a trigeminal nucleus. It arises from trigeminal nucleus. Okay. And it is believed that if there is ischemia or reduction in blood supply in these neurons of trigeminal nucleus, these neurons in trigeminal nucleus, they release, when there is ischemia, they release certain inflammatory chemicals. Like example, they release inflammatory chemicals like CGRP, that is calcitonin gene related peptide. Okay. Now, these calcitonin gene related peptide, when they are released, they will act on other neurons. And these neurons, they go to thalamus, they will become stimulated, and hypothalamus. And because of this reason, there is pain, and generally hypothalamus is believed to cause aura. Okay. So this is the inflammation. Now, why there is inflammation? Because the artery and the veins, which are bringing the blood, they becomes constricted. Because of this reason, there is reduction in blood supply to these neurons. And when they become ischemic, during ischemia, they release certain inflammatory mediators, which will lead to pain. Now, what is the role of tryptons? What is the action of tryptons? Okay. Now, tryptons has believed that it has two mechanisms of action. Okay. Now, tryptons, they can directly act on 5-HT1B and 1D receptor, which are present on these neurons, and as they are inhibitory receptor in CNS, they are GI type, they inhibit the release of inflammatory mediators. Okay. And second point is, what happens when there is reduction in blood supply because of vasoconstriction, whatever the blood which was coming to this neurons through artery, it gets diverted towards the vein. All the blood gets diverted towards the vein. Why? Because there is dilatation of arteriovenous anastomosis. As there is dilatation of arteriovenous anastomosis, the blood which is coming to these neurons get diverted towards the vein. Hence, this blood does not go to the neurons, they suffer from ischemia. Now, tryptans, remember, they are very powerful vasoconstrictors. Tryptans, they are very powerful vasoconstrictor. They cause constriction of or closure of this arteriovenous anastomosis. They cause closure of arteriovenous anastomosis. Okay. Because of this reason, now the blood will go to the neurons and properly come back also. Okay. So this is the mechanism of action. So they inhibit the release of inflammatory mediators and they also produce vasoconstriction. Okay. Now here the point comes. So in migraine, remember they reduce headache. And you will write they are the most effective drug to reduce this pain. And they also decrease aura like nausea and vomiting. They also reduce nausea and vomiting, but you will write less effective. That is why to reduce nausea and vomiting, we have to combine with these drugs with some anti-emetic drug from outside. Hence, we have to combine other anti-emetic drugs. But do they reduce nausea and vomiting? The answer is yes, but less as compared to other antiemetics. So let's see what are the drugs we have among tryptans. The first drug which we made among tryptans, the very famous drug, that is sumatriptan. So they are 5-HT1B1D agonist. Okay. Then we made many other drugs like zolmitriptan. Okay. We made many other drugs, so we will write the names first. We will write rizatriptan, elitriptan, naratriptan, frovatriptan. So as you see, they all are ending with the word triptan. And lastly, elmotriptan. Okay. Now let's see what is the route of administration. How do they give? How we give? Remember, all these drugs, they can be given orally. All are given orally. But there is a point out here. As we know that in migraine, there is nausea and vomiting. So sometimes it becomes very difficult to give a drug orally. Because of this reason, this sumatriptan and zolmitriptan, they are available, apart from orally, they are also available nasally as well. Okay, and this sumatriptan is also given as a subcutaneous injection. It is also given rectally. And earlier there was a transdermal preparation which has been banned now. Okay, now it is also given sublingually. So these are the preparations of sumatriptan. So sumatriptan, because of this reason, as it can be given by many route, it is the most commonly used drug. It is the most commonly used drug. Okay. Now rizatriptan, we will write, rizatriptan is the fastest acting drug. Okay. It is the fastest acting drug. Elitriptan, you will write, it is the most, it has the most favorable outcome. That means the best result is seen with elitriptan. Best effect is seen with elitriptan. E for effect, E for elitriptan. Naratriptan, we will write most potent. That means it required least dose. Why? Because it has best oral bioavailability. Okay, Rovatriptan is the longest acting drug. So some people give them for prevention also, but remember, triptans are not given for prevention of or prophylaxis of migraine, but because it is a long acting, some people they give, but it is not approved for this condition. And amlodipine is the safest one. Amlodipine is the safest one. So remember this part. Now let's see what is the side effect of this triptans. As we know that these triptans, they are vasoconstrictors. Because of this reason, they cause coronary artery vasospasm. They cause coronary vasospasm. Because of this reason, they are absolutely contraindicated in angina and MI patient, because it will reduce the blood supply to the heart because of coronary vasoconstriction. Okay, they also cause hypertension. Because of this reason, they are absolutely contraindicated in those people who have uncontrolled hypertension. Those people who have uncontrolled hypertension. Okay, and they may also cause arrhythmias on heart. Why they cause arrhythmia on heart? Because it is now believed that there are certain 5-HT1B1D receptor present on heart also, which can lead to arrhythmias. Okay, now last point is pregnancy. Now the safest drug among triptans in pregnancy is sumatriptan. Okay, sumatriptan. But remember, the drug of choice for acute migraine in pregnancy is not triptans. The drug of choice in pregnancy is NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. But among triptan, the safest drug we have is sumatriptan. Okay, the safest drug we have is sumatriptan. Okay, now the last point we have to write, that triptans should never be combined with ergots. Triptans and ergots, because ergots are also given for the treatment of migraine, you'll write never combine them. Okay, because they both are vasoconstrictors, BP will, their side effect will add on. Okay, so there should be at least gap of 24 hours. At least gap of 24 hours between ergots and triptans. But triptans are the drug of choice for acute attack of migraine. Now let's talk about ergots. Now ergots are the alkaloids like substance. Their structure is alkaloid, which are derived from a fungus, which is produced by a fungus known as Claviceps purpura. It is made by a fungus known as Claviceps purpura, and this fungus generally affect grains like rye. This fungus infect the grains like rye, and that disease, a very old disease, is known as ergot of rye, because ergot are the chemical produced by Claviceps purpura. Okay, now the point is, the first ergot, there are certain ergots. What are the examples of ergots we have? So let's see. So the first example is amide. Based upon their structure, we will derive them. Let's classify ergots on the basis of structure. One is amide containing. Okay, that ergot is known as lysergic diethylamide. As you see, amide word is coming. Now it is also known as LSD. Okay, now remember, this ergot is nowhere used. This ergot is not used. Why? Because this is a very potent hallucinogen. It causes hallucinations. It causes hallucinations in our brain. Okay, by acting on a receptor in our brain known as 5-HT2A receptor. So it stimulates this receptor. and person suffers from hallucination. From the discovery of this lysergic diethylamide, we made a drug. Okay, so it causes hallucination. Hallucination is also known as psychosis. Because of this reason, we made a drug that is 5-HT2A blocker. That drug was olanzapine and clozapine. And these drugs, they have discovered on the basis of this, they are just opposite drug. They have been developed as an anti-psychotic drug. Okay? Antipsychotic. So, lysergic diethylamide is not used. Let's see what are the other drugs we have. Let's see what are the other drugs. Now we have is amine containing. Amine containing. In amine containing, we have ergometrin. Ergometrin is also known as ergonovin. So it's a natural compound. And we have modified this ergometrin into dihydroergometrin. And methyl ergometrin. Methyl ergometrin is also known as methergin. Okay. Now these ergots, remember, they mainly act on a receptor in our body known as oxytocin receptor. They stimulate oxytocin receptor in our body predominantly, plus other receptor as well. It can act on other receptor as well, but their main action is on oxytocin receptor. And what they will do by stimulating oxytocin receptor, they cause contraction of uterus. They cause contraction of uterus. Because of this reason, they are used in the treatment of postpartum hemorrhage. Because if you will contract the uterus, the blood vessels between the muscles of uterus will also contract and the bleeding will stop. So they are used in the treatment of postpartum hemorrhage. But remember, they are contraindicated in induction of labor. When you want to induce labor so that the child should come out. So they are contraindicated in induction of labor. Okay. Why? Because they cause fetal hypoxia. The blood vessel becomes so much constricted that the fetus suffers from hypoxia. Because of this reason, remember now, the drug of choice for both postpartum hemorrhage, induction of labor, as well as augmentation of labor has now become just and just oxytocin. So oxytocin has now become the drug of choice for postpartum hemorrhage, induction of labor and augmentation of labor. So these drugs were used earlier. Now it is not used. Because of this reason, remember, any ergot compound, if you are using for some other purpose, is contraindicated in pregnancy. Okay. Now, the second class of ergot we have is amino acid ergot, amino acid structure. Those which have amino acid structure. Okay. So in amino acid structure, we have ergotamine. And we have ergotoxin. Ergotoxin. Okay? So now let's see where they will act. This ergotamine, it mainly acts on serotonin receptor, that is 5-HT1B1D agonist. So as we know that it is acting just like triptans, hence it is used in the treatment of acute attack of migraine. Okay, so it is used in the treatment of acute attack of migraine. Ergotamine. So which drug among ergot we use in migraine? That is ergotamine. And from ergotamine we have made dihydroergotamine. we have made dihydroergotamine. Now dihydroergotamine, remember, it has less effect on serotonin 5-HT1B1D receptor. When we have added hydrogen, it has become less effective on serotonin. It has more become effective in cases of, it has more property of alpha blocker. Remember, alpha blocker are also vasoconstrictors. So these two ergots are given in the treatment of migraine. Now how ergot is given? Ergotamine is given orally. While this dihydroergotamine can be given nasally as well as by injection. Okay. But remember, as we know that triptans, they were reducing nausea and vomiting in migraine. Remember, these ergots, they increase nausea and vomiting. So remember, triptans, they reduce nausea and vomiting, which is seen in migraine. Rather, they will increase nausea and vomiting. Okay, so that I'll tell you, because some of them also act on dopamine receptors. Let's talk about ergotoxin, and we have made dihydroergotoxin. Now dihydroergotoxin is also known as cadargocrine. Okay. Now, where these drugs are used, remember, these drugs have been tried in the treatment of dementia or memory loss. Why? Because these drugs, they increase memory. Okay, these drugs, they increase memory. So ergotoxin and dihydroergotoxin, which is also known as cadargocrine, they are used in the treatment of dementia. Okay, now the third class of ergot we have is now synthetic ergots. Fourth type, we have certain synthetic derivative. Among synthetic derivatives, we have bromocriptine, cabergoline. So these are also synthetic drug. Quinagolide, and pergolide. Okay, now these synthetic ergots, remember, they act on a receptor known as D2 receptor, and they stimulate D2 receptor, hence they are D2 receptor agonist. D stand for dopamine. Okay, so they have predominant action on these receptor. Because of this reason, these drugs, they are used in the treatment of Parkinson's disease, because in Parkinson's, the level of dopamine reduces. They are also used in the treatment of when the level of prolactin increases, known as prolactinoma, because they will suppress prolactin release. And prolactin, we know, it is responsible for lactation, hence they are used to suppress lactation. Okay, so for the complete details of bromocriptine and cabergoline, please refer to the videos of endocrine. Okay, in endocrine, refer to the video of hypothalamic pituitary axis. Okay, we have discussed the full treatment. Okay, so let's make a summary of this ergots which we have written. Okay, let's make a summary of ergots which we have written. So ergot drugs which we have written are, which predominantly act on oxytocin receptor and they stimulate it, which will act on serotonin receptor 5-HT1B1D and they stimulate it, and the drug which act on dopamine D2 receptor and stimulate it. Okay, stimulate it. So among oxytocin, we have written ergometrin. So metrin, how we can remember? Oxytocin act on uterus. The muscles of uterus is known as myometrium. Okay, so metrin word, dihydroergometrin. So you have attached dihydro group and methyl ergometrin, which is also known as methergine. Okay, and they were used in postpartum hemorrhage. used in the treatment of postpartum hemorrhage. Then serotonin, ergotamine, and dihydroergotamine. Dihydroergotamine has more of alpha blocking property. They are used in acute migraine. And dopamine, we have written bromocriptine, cabergoline, quinagolide, pergolide. So they are given in various conditions like Parkinson's and prolactinoma. Okay, they are given in Parkinson's and prolactinomas. Now let's see what is the side effect of ergots. Okay, let's talk about the side effects of ergot drugs. Now remember, the side effect of ergots are known as ergotism. Okay, it is known as ergotism, and it can be explained on the basis of these three receptors. Okay, so we will write a mnemonic. What are the side effects which we seen in cases of ergotism? We'll write a mnemonic: paper, paper, VCD, okay. So the first one is they cause, the first one that they cause is postural hypotension. Why they cause postural hypotension? Because they dilate large vessel. Dilate large vessel. Because of D2 agonist property, dopamine stimulate large vessels. Okay? So they cause postural hypotension. A for abortion. So because of this reason, remember, ergots are category X drug. Ergots are category X drug. They should not be given in pregnancy. Okay. Now, why? Because they stimulate oxytocin receptor. Then they cause psychosis. Because they stimulate serotonin receptor. E for in limbs, they cause redness, erythro. Melos matlab limb. Algia means pain. Redness and pain in limbs known as erythromelalgia. Okay, they also cause Raynaud's disease. Raynaud's means they will cause obstruction of end arteries or constriction of end arteries. So due to constriction of end arteries, because of the release of serotonin, serotonin causes constriction of end arteries, which can lead to dry gangrene of limbs, especially digits. Okay, digits, fingers. Okay, now they also cause vomiting, nausea and vomiting. Because dopamine receptor, they are present in our brain, they cause nausea and vomiting. They cause cardiac valvular fibrosis. Cardiac valvular fibrosis. Because of this reason, one ergot got banned. The ergot got banned due to cardiac valvular fibrosis was pergolide. It was approved for Parkinson, but it got banned. And lastly, they also cause retroperitoneal fibrosis. They also cause retroperitoneal fibrosis. Because of this reason, one ergot got banned. That was the first drug for migraine. That drug was methisergide. Okay? Methisergide. It was also an ergot, but it got banned. So these are the side effects of ergotism. Okay? Ergotism. Okay? So this is about ergots. Now, Let's talk about the other receptors of serotonin, and then we will see the treatment of migraine, which drug we use for the treatment of migraine. So let's talk about now other receptors of serotonin. Okay, so other receptors, we will go further with 5-HT2 receptors. 5-HT2 receptor. The 5-HT2 receptor is GQ type. It increases IP3 DAC. Okay. Now, there are various subtypes of 5-HT2 receptor like 5-HT2A, 2B, 2C, etc. Okay. So, if you talk about a drug, first agonist and antagonist. Antagonist means blocker. Okay. Now, we have a drug known as lorcaserine. Lorcaserine. Lorcaserine is 5-HT2C agonist. Okay. Among antagonists, we have antipsychotic like clozapine, olanzapine, etc. Okay, now let's see where it is present. 5-HT2 receptor. This 5-HT2 receptor, remember, it is present in our brain, and in our brain it is present in an area known as cortex, and we know in cortical area we have thoughts. Increase in serotonin level in cortex causes abnormal thoughts or psychosis. Okay. So serotonin, when increase in cortex, increases psychosis, and it is also present in hypothalamus, and increase in serotonin, remember, decreases appetite. We will feel not hungry. Now this lorcaserine, it is an approved anti-obesity drug. It is an approved anti-obesity drug because it suppresses appetite. Okay, and these drugs are antipsychotic drugs, so they will reduce the level of serotonin in cortical area. But if you talk about their side effect, the side effect of lorcaserine is psychosis, and the side effect of antipsychotics like clozapine and olanzapine is weight gain. So they are just opposite drug, they cause obesity. Okay, and maximum weight gain is by clozapine among all antipsychotics. Okay, now let's talk about certain other drugs which are antagonist only. So we will write certain other drugs which are antagonist. We will write methysergide. Methysergide was the first drug which was developed for prevention of migraine, but we know it got banned. It was given for prevention of migraine, but we have discussed that it got banned because it was an ergot. It was causing retroperitoneal fibrosis. Then we have a drug, ketanserine. Very important. Ketanserine is the most specific drug which act as a 5-HT2 antagonist. Okay, ketanserine. And lastly, we have ciproheptadine. Ciproheptadine. Now, ciproheptadine, remember, it is anti-serotonin that we know. It is also antihistaminic drug. It also blocks histamine receptor, and it also has anticholinergic property. It also blocks acetylcholine receptors. Okay, because of this reason, it can be given in allergic conditions also. Okay, so please refer to the chapter of antihistaminic. We have discussed about ciproheptadine. So this is about 5-HT2 receptor. Let's talk about 5-HT3 receptor. Now, 5-HT3 receptor is an ionotropic receptor, so it was the only exception. Okay, and it conducts sodium. When this, it is an excitable, it conducts sodium. Now, where it is present? Now, sir, 5-HT3 receptor is present in two locations, one in brain. Now, in brain, it is present in an area of our brain known as CTZ area. CTZ stands for chemoreceptor trigger zone, also known as vomiting center of our brain. Now, 5-HT3 receptor is present in vomiting center. It is the vomiting center, CTZ, chemoreceptor trigger zone, vomiting center. Now, when serotonin will act here, remember, it causes vomiting. Okay, it causes vomiting. And it is also present in our GIT. And when serotonin act here, remember, it increases the motility of GIT. Hence, the person will suffer from diarrhea. Okay, so that is why we have developed 5-HT3 antagonist. 5-HT3 antagonist. So these drugs, they will block this receptor and vomiting will stop. So these drugs are anti-emetics. Why? Because they will stop vomiting. And these drugs, they are also given for the treatment of diarrhea. So they will inhibit, decrease the motility, and the diarrhea will stop. So they are also given for the treatment of diarrhea, which is seen in cases of irritable bowel syndrome. IBS is irritable bowel syndrome. So let's see what are the drugs. Remember, any drug which is a 5-HT3 antagonist, it will end with the word cetron. Okay. So we'll write ondansetron. It's an anti-emetic drug. Ondansetron, granicetron, tropicetron, and palonosetron. And we will write most commonly this is used ondansetron, and ondansetron is the drug of choice for CINV, that is chemotherapy induced nausea and vomiting. Chemotherapy means anti-cancer drug. Anti-cancer drug, they cause nausea and vomiting. So chemotherapy induced nausea and vomiting, they are also the drug of choice for RINV, that is radiotherapy induced nausea and vomiting. Okay, but remember, among them, this palonosetron is the longest and most potent drug. Most potent, and because of this reason, it will act beyond 24 hours. CINV has two phase. Within 24 hours is known as early phase. If it continue beyond 24 hours, this is known as delayed phase. Only palonosetron is effective in delayed phase of chemotherapy induced nausea and vomiting, and this one. So please refer to the videos of antiemetics for more details. And lastly, we have a drug, ramucirumab. Okay. Now here, the drug which will act as an anti-motility drug for the treatment of diarrhea in IBS is elocetron. But remember, elocetron is only given in females. And another drug is, again, we will write ramucirumab. So ramucirumab is given in both cases. So 5-HT3 blocker, remember, they are given as an anti-emetic drug because they will block serotonin receptor in our brain, and they also block serotonin receptor in our intestine, hence the motility will reduce. Okay, now let's talk about the last receptor, that is 5-HT4 receptor. Okay, now remember, 5-HT4 receptor, they are GS type, they increase cyclic AMP level. And remember, the rest of the receptor, that is 5-HT5, 6 and 7, they are also GS type. Okay. But we have a drug which will act here. Now, where 5-HT4 receptor is present, remember, 5-HT4 receptor is also present in our GIT. And it is present in stomach. Stomach. As well as intestine. And in both stomach and intestine, remember, it will increase. When serotonin act, it will increase motility. okay, it will increase motility. So can we say the food which is present in stomach will come down very easily? If the food will come down very easily, the food will not get reflux to esophagus. Hence, these drug, remember, they are known as, now we have a drug, known as 5-HT4 agonist or stimulator. So can we say that these drugs, they will increase motility of our GIT? That is why these drugs are known as prokinetic drug. Pro means increasing, kinetic means motility of our intestine and stomach. Now, as the motility of stomach will increase, the food will come very forward, very rapidly downwards. Hence, it will not reflux upwards. So, it is used for the treatment of GERD. GERD stands for gastroesophageal reflux disease. When the food is moving upwards toward the esophagus, they will increase the motility of stomach. The food will come very rapidly to the intestine. And they are also present in intestine. And when the motility of intestine will act, can we say the food will be ingested out in feces? So because of this reason, the other use is, they are used for the treatment of constipation when the food is not passing out. So remember, prokinetic drugs, they have two uses. One is GERD and second we have is constipation. Now let's see what are the drugs we have. So the drugs we have are CTMIP. The drug was sizapride, mozapride, procaloprid. So you are seeing they all are ending with the word pride and renzapride. They all are ending with the word pride. Pride means prokinetic drug. PR word is coming. But there is a little bit different drug, tigasirod. So this is a different name. So you must remember them. Tigasirod. Okay. Now remember, these first two drugs, they got banned. Why? Because these drugs, they were increasing QT interval on ECG. Why? Because they block potassium channel on heart. So any drug that block potassium channel on heart increases QT interval on ECG. How it increases? Please refer to the videos of arrhythmia. And because of this reason, it was causing a fatal arrhythmia known as torsades de pointis. Torsades de pointis is a very fatal type of ventricular fibrillation or ventricular tachycardias, which could be very dangerous. Patient can die suddenly. Hence, these two drugs got withdrawn from the market. Now, mozapride is available, but remember, mozapride also increased QT interval. But prucalopride and renzapride have not shown to increase in QT interval. That is why these drugs, they are given in GERD and constipation. And this prucalopride has been approved for the treatment of idiopathic constipation recently. It has been approved for the treatment of idiopathic constipation. Okay, so prucalopride and renzapride do not cause QT interval prolongation. So this is all about the drugs which will act at the level of serotonin. So let's talk about now the treatment of migraine. Okay, so let's talk about migraine treatment. So we know now what is migraine. Migraine is a type of headache. Okay, what type? The characteristics are, it is unilateral, throbbing, and severe in intensity. And it is associated with symptoms known as aura. In aura, the patient has nausea and vomiting, and photophobia, and phonophobia. Okay, now let's see what is the treatment of migraine headache. Now For the treatment of migraine, remember we have two treatment goals. First, if the patient will come you with acute migraine means acute attack of migraine. Then we have to terminate this acute attack. And if the patient is a patient of chronic migraine means the patient is having very frequent attack, we have to give prevention, we have to prevent, we have to give prophylaxis of migraine. Okay, so in chronic migraine, we give prophylactic drugs so that headache should not occur. So let's see first what are the drugs we have for acute attack of migraine. Then we will come to chronic migraine. Now, acute attack of migraine, remember they are divided into three on the basis of severity. Okay, we can divide acute attack of migraine into mild, moderate, and severe. Okay, mild, moderate, and severe variety. We will ask the patient how many in mild variety of migraine. Remember, the patient has less than one attack per month, and each attack is less than 8 hours, and it is tolerable to the patient. In severe, it is at least one or more than one attack per month, and it could be up to 24 hours. It could be up to 24 hours, whole day. And the patient is functionally impaired. That means the patient cannot do work. And in severe, the patient have at least two or three attacks. At least two or three attacks. It could be more than two or three attacks per month. The patient is incapacitated. Patient is bedridden. And each attack can last for more than 48 hours. For 2 days continuously. Okay. Now let's see what are the drugs we give for acute attack of migraine. Okay. So, if the patient is having mild migraine, remember the drug of choice is NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. Okay, NSAIDs. So, we can give simple NSAIDs, that means single drug, like paracetamol, aspirin, naproxen, ibuprofen, and diclofenac. Or we can give their combination as well. So let's see what are the various approved combination we know. So we will write, we have a combination of paracetamol PCM with aspirin with caffeine. Remember, caffeine also reduces headache, which is present in coffee. So coffee is good for headache or like migraine. We have a combination of aspirin with a prokinetic drug metoclopramide, which we will be discussing shortly. We have a combination of naproxen with a triptan known as sumatriptan. Okay. So this combination. So for mild cases, remember the drug of choice is NSAIDs. And remember, it is also the drug of choice in pregnancy. NSAIDs are the drug of choice for migraine in pregnancy also. Now, if this headache is not controlled or it is moderate to severe variety, then remember the overall drug of choice for the acute treatment of migraine is triptans. It is considered overall the drug of choice, triptans. Okay. So what are triptans? Which they are 5-HT, 1B, 1D agonist. You can also use ergots, but remember, they should never be combined together. These two drugs should never be combined together. Either give triptan or give ergots, but the drug of choice is triptans. Okay? The drug of choice is triptans. And we know various triptans which we have already written. Okay? Like sumatriptan, wagera. And ergots we have already written. Ergotamine, dihydroergotamine. Okay? Sir, if it is still not responsive, then add. If it is still not responsive, then add D2 blocker. So D2 blocker, remember, they are just add-on drug. They are adjunctive drug. Now, what is the advantage of giving D2 blocker? Remember, D2 blocker, they are more effective in aura. Aura means they will reduce nausea and vomiting. But remember, they are less effective for headache. For headache, the best drug we have is triptans. So D2 blocker, they are more effective in aura, like to suppress nausea and vomiting. And remember, they also increase the effect of triptans. They also increase the effect of triptans. So we add them. So various D2 blocker which we can give are, so these D2 blockers which we can give various oral D2 blocker. We can give IV also. Why IV? If a patient cannot take a drug orally, we can start IV drug. Okay, so we can write certain oral and IV drugs. So in oral, we can write metoclopramide, domperidone, and prochlorperazine. Prochlorperazine is an antipsychotic drug, but it is a D2 blocker. All antipsychotics are D2 blocker. Among IV, we can write these are approved IV drugs also. But there is one more drug which can be given IV, that is chlorpromazine. Chlorpromazine. So it's an approved drug. Now sometimes if it is still not responsive, not controlled or not responsive, as a last resort, we can give opioids. So as a last resort, we can give opioids, we can give oral opioid, we can give IV opioid, we can give intranasal opioid. Okay, so in oral and IV, we can give morphine, pethidine, etc. While in intranasal, we have the only intranasal opioid we have is butorphanol. Okay. So this is how we will proceed for the treatment of migraine, acute attack of migraine. Now let's talk about prevention or prophylaxis of migraine. Prophylaxis of migraine. Now prophylaxis of migraine is given in the cases of chronic migraine. It is given in the cases of chronic migraine. Okay, now in chronic migraine, remember what is the definition of chronic migraine? When we need to give a preventive drug, remember, if this headache, if the headache of a patient is lasting for more than 15 days in 1 month, for 3 months, then we classify the patient as chronic migraine. So that means in 30 days, the patient has headache for more than 15 days and it is happening from past 3 consecutive months. Then we classify the patient as chronic migraine, and here we need to give a drug for prophylaxis of migraine. So let's see what are the drugs. Now the drug of choice for prophylaxis of migraine is beta blockers. The drug of choice for prophylaxis of migraine is beta blocker. So the best beta blocker we have is propranolol. We can also use, you will write a mnemonic PMT, metoprolol and timolol. These are the three best beta blockers we have for the treatment of migraine, and propranolol is the best drug because beta blockers are vasoconstrictors, just like triptans. So beta blocker, they block beta receptor. Due to blockage of beta receptor, there is unopposed action on alpha receptor. They act as a vasoconstrictors. Okay. Now, the second class of drug, if there is no response, we can give anti-epileptics. Anti-epileptics. The anti-epileptic drugs which are approved are valproic acid or valproate. There is a form of valproate known as divalproic sodium, which is given orally, has a better absorption. We can also give topiramate. We can also give topiramate and gabapentin. And a congener of gabapentin is pregabalin. So these three anti-epileptics are approved and the best drug. And these two classes of drug, they have best evidence or best results. Because of safety profile, we start with beta blocker. Now let's see what are the other drugs which we give for prophylaxis of migraine. Okay, but remember, the evidence that they are more effective is probably lacking. They are less evidence we have that they are effective. We have less evidence that they are effective drugs or not, but still we give. Okay, so let's see what are the drug. We have one drug, flunarizine. Sorry, we'll use a drug, you'll write calcium channel blocker. Okay, the drug name is flunarizine, which is a better drug than a drug known as verapamil. Okay, so remember, flunarizine is given for prophylaxis of migraine, but remember, verapamil is given for prophylaxis of migraine, but verapamil is also given in heart conditions as well. But flunarizine is not given in heart disease, it is only given in migraine. Fourth, we will write, we have tricyclic antidepressants. Like amitriptyline, nortriptyline. Okay. Fifth, we have anti-serotonin, which will block 5-HT2 receptor. The drugs are ketanserin, ciproheptadine, and the first drug for migraine which we made was methysergide. It was the first drug for migraine, but now this drug has been banned. Why? Because it was an ergot drug, it causes retroperitoneal fibrosis. So it got banned. Okay, let's talk about next drug, that is a new drug now, a new drug recently been approved, that is erinumab. The drug name is erinumab. Erinumab is a monoclonal antibody. Okay, that blocks CGRP. If you remember, I told you that the nerves, they release an inflammatory mediator CGRP, that is calcitonin gene related peptide, and this inflammatory marker, it stimulates nerves which leads to pain. Okay, so it has been recently been approved for prophylaxis of migraine, erinumab. So it's a monoclonal antibody that blocks CGRP. Okay, so these are the drugs which are approved. Now remember, There are certain drugs which are under trial. Okay, the drugs are all CGPant, Tel-KG-Pant. As you are seeing, CG word is coming, so they are CGRP. They are also CGRP, that is calcitonin gene related peptide. ANT means receptor antagonist. Okay, but now these drugs are not approved. Right now, they are not approved. Okay, now there is a herbal medication, a plant product, which is found to be very effective in the prophylaxis of migraine. That herbal or plant product is Pitasites. Pitasites. It's a plant product which is sometimes known as butter bur plant. It is a highly effective drug for prophylaxis of migraine. Okay, and lastly, there is a drug which is under trial, that is Lasmiditan. That is 5-HT1F agonist. It is right now not approved, still under trial for acute attack of migraine. Very soon this drug will get approved, but right now it is not approved. Okay, right now not approved. So this is all about the treatment of migraine. Okay, this is all about now the treatment of migraine. So thank you very much. Okay, but before that point, please write one additional point which we missed. Please write one additional point which we missed in this ergot part. We have discussed that ergot causes ergotism, and in ergotism there is vasoconstriction due to unned arteries, which was causing dry gangrene of limbs and Raynaud's phenomena. Remember, for the treatment of this obstruction of arteries, we give a vasodilator. If the patient will come to you with obstruction of arteries, give a vasodilator nitroprusside. Okay, so we give a drug nitroprusside for the treatment of this dry gangrene of limbs and Raynaud's disease. Okay, so this is drug we give for the treatment of ergotism. So this point we missed. So this is all about the treatment of migraine, and these are the drugs which are herbal medication, not our context, and these drugs are under clinical trials. So thank you very much.